आस न्याय का सबके लिए आकाश न्याय का सबके लिए।
Hello everyone, a very good evening to all of you. I'm Advocate Jatin Ramaya and I welcome you all to Goa State Legal Services Authority's Virtual Juridicare Series. As you all know, by means of Virtual Juridicare Series, Goa State Legal Services Authority endeavors to talk about issues, rights, obligations and things that affect us, things which have a legal connection. And every week we try to bring such a new discussion with such a new resource person and enlighten or create awareness about these topics. But today's edition is slightly different. Today's edition is slightly different because for the first time we are going to discuss about professional ethics and etiquettes of a practicing lawyer. Well, it's also different because we have a very distinguished resource person. This resource person is a former Air Force officer and also a very distinguished senior advocate in the state of Goa. Well, he was designated the senior gown by the Bombay High Court some about 25-28 years ago, and since then he has a roaring practice in different arenas. His practice ranges from criminal to arbitrations to civil work to a lot of other spheres of law which one cannot even imagine. We have none other than Senior Advocate Suren Desai to speak about professional ethics and etiquettes. Over to you, sir.
My dear friends, I have chosen a topic which is very popular, but yet so unpopular with lawyers. The topic for today is professional ethics and etiquettes. I don't wish to tell you, because you are all lawyers, about the laws, about the Advocates Act, about the Bar Council Act, about the rules providing the professional ethics and etiquettes and all that. You're all aware of it. I also don't wish to tell you about the Goa State Legal Services Authority creation and the law on the subject. I'm going to tell you something different. You can just find out whether it is really different or it is most important. The first ethic or etiquette, according to me, is the respect for judiciary. The respect of for judiciary destines your career as a lawyer, as an advocate. As a child, you are bound to respect your parents. You are bound to respect your elder members of the family. I must tell you about a person, how he was destined to become a lawyer, out of respect to his parents, out of respect to his elder member of the family. A man from the village, he was a matriculate, then SSC, 11th standard, at very early age of 16 years, which was not possible then in Portuguese ruled Goa, because you had to compulsorily study what is known as primeiro grau, that is primary education in Portuguese, which the gentleman had to undergo. But still being from a village, he managed to pass his SSC at the age of 16. And look at the misfortune that occurred to him. He had to go to Bombay on a passport for appearing in the SSC exam, which he appeared in 3 papers. And then he got chickenpox. He could not attend his other papers, in spite of the fact that somebody came shouting that there is somebody who is known to you, who is your relation, who is in the government printing press in Maharashtra. I think she is going to get you some papers in advance. Anyway, that was of no use. It is just a past. Then he appeared again in October 1961 and passed. That's how 1 year was lost. So in 62, he started in a college in Goa. And his elder brother said, you must do science. He was not science oriented at all. But somebody said, this is the respect to elder member of the family, as you should have respect for the judiciary. He went into the science stream and did not do well. The next day, his brother said, Mister, you forget that. You become a diploma engineer. I will put you in Polytechnic in Panjim. I started in Panjim as first year diploma student in, I think, mechanical engineering. Then what happened was, during the time he was in Panjim, his elder brother met a recruitment officer who had come to Goa from somewhere rest of India to recruit airmen into the Indian Air Force. So his brother was impressed. He said, yes, I must have my brother as a pilot in the Indian Air Force, and I want him to be a war pilot. Very wonderful sequence. So the recruiting officer told him, yes, if your brother wants to become a pilot, he can still get into the Air Force as a technician, as a ground engineer, for which he'll be trained. And he can definitely become a pilot if he's so qualified, being an airman in the Indian Air Force. The elder brother fell for it. He convinced his younger brother to join the Indian Air Force. The younger brother was also obsessed with the idea of becoming a war pilot or a fighter pilot in the Indian Air Force. It went on. He joined the Indian Air Force and signed compulsorily for a period of 9 years for being trained as an airman in a technical trade as a ground engineer. That went on. Being in the Air Force, he started to appear in the examination for qualifying him to be a pilot. He did once or twice. Unfortunately, it did not click. Then he thought, no longer try. He must get out from the Indian Air Force because he cannot become a pilot. He thought of going out. He was just immatriculate. Where's the question of going out after 10 years or 9 years, that too as a matriculate? So he thought of improving his educational qualifications. He was posted in Punjab. So he graduated from Punjab University. Then he was posted in Bangalore. After he was posted in Bangalore, he wanted to pursue his graduation to the post-graduation in arts. Again, his elder brother comes in. He says, Mr. No, you take some professional degree. Why do you want to become an MA? Younger brother listened to his brother, elder brother, out of respect. And not choosing his career, not wanting to become a lawyer, the younger brother completed his LLB whilst being in the Indian Air Force. Then he thought of getting out of the Indian Air Force. He was discharged voluntarily after a period of 9 years, factually after a period of 10 years. And he started his career as a lawyer after, of course, obtaining a sanad. Again, there was a problem. But being a man in the Air Force for a period of nearly 10 years, that taught you indirectly the equality subject. That told you what is Article 14 of the Constitution of India. That told you that every human being is equal, whether he is well-placed, inferiorly placed, or whatever he was. And you are bound to treat him with equal discrimination, with equality, and in terms of all things that can be considered as equal. It also taught him, what is Article 13? It taught him, you cannot discriminate on the ground of inferiority, sex, caste, creed, or any of this. So naturally, he earned the basics of law or the constitution of India, at least the few basics of it, whilst being in the Air Force. After he came out from the Indian Air Force, he joined somebody as a junior. When he joined as a junior, he was not earning anything. He was not supposed to. But whilst being in the Air Force, he was earning so much so, he was sending part of his earnings every month to his parents at the age of 19, 18 or 20 until he was 25, 26. Now, having earned for years, for nearly 10 years and not earning anything at the end of 10 years was a problem. But the courage, which a lawyer also should have, the courage to pursue a career despite warts, despite calamities, despite misfortunes, is one of the basic ethic and etiquette which is required of a lawyer, so that not only he can respect the judiciary, but he can fearlessly counter any misfortune and fearlessly practice. So this fearlessness the gentleman got whilst being in the Air Force. He loved the world, loved every human being around whilst being in the Air Force. He loved the concept of equality, irrespective of caste, creed, trade, tribe, whilst being in the Air Force. So Air Force taught him what ethically a lawyer should understand as a beginning lawyer. This is the second principle, according to me, of professional ethic and etiquette. The third principle of professional ethic and etiquette is fearlessness. And a person can be fearless if he is honest to the core. This quality also the gentleman earned whilst being in the Indian Air Force, because he had to fearlessly face the situation around and fearlessly understand the consequences for which he is inducted into the Indian Air Force. And having seen two wars in 1965 and 1971, he had become fearless. A lawyer should equally be fearless. Fearless and honest. If a lawyer is honest, ethically he should be, then he has to be honest to the law. If he is honest to the law, he will understand that he cannot turn black into white or white into black. He has to understand the white as mentioned in the law and dress that white to the facts which can be derived from the truths of the case of your client. So in order to become a good lawyer, you should be honest to the law and honestly dress the client's case to meet the law or to understand the law or to interpret the law in his favor, but not misinterpret. And then the last thing the gentleman had was that he was tirelessly working for 10 years in the Indian Air Force. And he was working at what times? Sometime in the morning shift, sometime in the afternoon shift, sometime in the night shift, which gave him the courage to work tirelessly in the profession. As a lawyer, one must tirelessly work to understand the case of his client, to interpret the case of his client, to adjust the case of his client in terms of law and project it properly in a court of law, fearlessly. Now it is said all around that judges have power and authority. It is said all around again that some judges who cannot shoulder that power and authority on their shoulders exceed their power and authority or misuse it. As a lawyer, one must fearlessly face it and bring it to the notice of the authorities concerned about this disqualification of a judicial officer. Ultimately, everybody needs today justice. Everybody is required to be administered justice. Can a judge who is not honest, can a judge who is not impartial, can a judge who is not serious, can a judge who is casual, can a judge who wants to interpret law by his own method or in terms of his own IQ without bothering about the law, without bothering about the seriousness in law, without bothering about the intention or object behind enacting a law, can such a judge be continued? If such a judge is continued, is not the client going to face failure of justice? Is not the client going to face miscarriage of justice? Therefore, the code of ethics and etiquettes, as mentioned in the Advocates Act and the code prescribed thereunder, says that a lawyer should fearlessly complain about misbehavior of a judge, as also fearlessly uphold the dignity of majesty of justice. According to me, a lawyer's profession is the best profession if it clicks. As a lawyer, you are independent. Whosoever comes to you is your client. He may be a small man, he may be a minister, he may be a collector, or he may be a judge sometimes in difficulty. Look at the expanse, look at the broad jurisdiction of your working. It would be better to continue as a lawyer if you click as a good lawyer, if you earn reputation as a lawyer, because if you thereafter pick up anything which is so attractive, you may lose independence. A man always needs independence. People have fought for independence. People have died for independence. And then if you can be in a free country independently working, why should you bind yourself under the color of power and authority? Is not a lawyer exercising or has power and authority as a good lawyer, fearless lawyer, honest lawyer who can work for his clients tirelessly to the best of his honest knowledge of law? That is what one of the etiquettes or one of the ethics of a good lawyer is. I am saying something before you on behalf of the Goa State Legal Services Authority, because this lecture is organized by the authority. Now, one of the ethics I would come to, or etiquette I would come to, is that a lawyer can have his personal institution of legal service or free legal aid by not charging the clients who do not have money to pay the lawyer, or charging them so less to accommodate them so that justice is delivered to him, to the poor client. Therefore, basic ethic and etiquette of a lawyer is to do legal service to a client who comes to him and not be bothered about the money he is supposed to pay to you on the basis of your stature and standing. You can ultimately, a busy lawyer can thus have many cases. There may be some cases which can be freely fought. There may be some cases which can be fought with legal fees or no fees. Is it not legal aid to the poor? Is it not attempt to see that justice is administered to a poor litigant? Such a big cause a lawyer can do. Therefore, this should be adopted as a basic ethic and etiquette of a practicing lawyer. One should not be so much bothered about the money he is making, because if he has a proper attitude to the profession, he has a proper attitude to the mankind around and where he can serve, he will automatically get what he otherwise deserves. A person selfishly insisting upon fees may not be so big at the end of the day, but a person who is not bothered about or strict about his fees will get some client who will willingly pay to him. That is much more than a lawyer trying to fleece his clients and not getting anything at the end of the day, because the client who cannot afford to pay will try to find out another lawyer who can at least fight for him with less money or no money. I have said, I think, so many things. I think I should say something more. During the last few years, judicial power has shot very high, so high that it is not resting on the broad shoulders of judges. They feel that their authority can do anything. Yes, they are entitled to pass a wrong judgment. They are entitled to harass a litigant thereby. They are entitled to administer injustice to a litigant before them for the said purpose. But is it going to help the cause of justice? Is it going to help the cause of administration of justice? What should happen to such judicial officers? The first ethic and etiquette of a lawyer to fearlessly fight this menace. And if it can be collectively fought, then there is no question of any single person being victimized. Collective effort is going to teach a lesson to the judicial officers and will make them administer justice honestly, fearlessly, and without any fear or bias. I have seen some judges in my younger days who were so fearless. I must tell you an instance. After Goa got a high court and was started as a bench of the Bombay High Court, we used to have judges, good judges, senior judges, coming to Goa as visiting judges and administering justice. I was a young fellow then, young practicing lawyer. And there was a tradition that when the judge is going after his tenure as a visiting judge or after 2 or 3 months or whatever time, a practice was developed to give him a farewell party. And one such judge was the guest in one of such farewell parties. And advocate who was appearing or going to appear against me was then the president of the High Court Bar Association. And being an office bearer, he was taking the host judge around and all the time was treating him and hobnobbing with him. I got worried. I thought tomorrow I'm going to lose the case. And next day, the case came between the senior lawyer and myself before the same judge who was hosted farewell the earlier day. When the matter came, the judge questioned me, "What is this, Mr. So-and-so?" I said, "It is not like that, sir. It is so-and-so is already over. Now it is being repeated by filing in a different way the same cause." He turned to the senior lawyer who had treated him earlier night, left, right and center. He said, "Mr. So-and-so, there is no second innings in one day match. What is happening? This cannot be here." And looking at him, into his eyes, he dismissed the cause picked up by the lawyer before him. So that is the honesty. That is the fearlessness. And we should have those judges who otherwise can mix with anyone, but who will not sell themselves for mixing. And they will understand their responsibility and honesty behind administering justice. Such judges can move around. It doesn't bother about them. It doesn't matter to them if they are with somebody or not. But when it comes to administer justice, they find out the papers and not the face of the person who is appearing before him. Now, this sort of justice, this sort of judiciary should be re-established if it is not there. And to re-establish such a judiciary, we, the lawyers as officers of courts, have a bigger responsibility. First, we have to object to the candidates trying to be judges who are otherwise dishonest or who otherwise can be dishonest or who will not administer honestly justice. We should also prop up the candidates who are honest, who may not be so smart, who may not be intellectually dishonest, or may not be so intellectual or intelligent, but as long as they're honest, they should be entertained, and it should be seen that they become judges. I think I have exceeded my time, and I have told you stories which strictly would not fall within the subject. But I honestly thought that instead of telling or discussing with such august gathering the provisions of the Advocates Act, the rules of ethics and etiquettes, or the provisions of the Bar Council Act, it is better to discuss something else out of somebody's experience. It is for you to decide whether it is good or bad. Fearlessness, I must tell you, you must be fearless as far as your colleague also is concerned, however big he may be. Recently, I found a senior advocate appearing for a client who happened to be his relation. And that was picked up by my client. So I said, "All right, if you want to put it, let us put it." And the objection was taken before the learned judge that this lawyer cannot appear in this matter because he is personally interested or particularly interested. The lawyer said, "What is this? If I have committed a misconduct, I should be taken before the Bar Council of India or the State Bar Council." And I said, "Yes, that will be done, but person should be given an opportunity to correct himself. If he doesn't understand it, doesn't want to have it, and according to me, even the court, if comes across a lawyer who is misconducting, has inherent power and jurisdiction to say that you will not appear in this case." Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for such an enlightening talk. I'm sure lawyers and young budding lawyers such as myself are definitely indebted to you for enlightening us on predicates of professional ethics and what is expected from a lawyer. And on this note, I also thank you for taking out time from your busier schedule. And to all the viewers, I request you to kindly like, follow and share this particular video. Thank you very much.
राष्ट्रीय न्यायिक सेवा प्राधिकरण
न्यायालयातल्या कारवाई खातीर बरो वकील मेळून दिता.
वेळार योग्य कायदा खालची मदत आणि सल्लो दिता.
लोक अदालत द्वारा चढ काळच्या केसीक बेगीन सोपयता.
आणि ते बी सामके मोफत.
राष्ट्रीय न्यायिक सेवा प्राधिकरण बेस बरो न्याय बेस बरो समाज.
अधिक माहिती खातीर लागच्या न्यायालयातल्या न्यायिक सेवा प्राधिकरण कार्यालयाला संपर्क करा
वा टोल फ्री नंबर 1500 फोन करा.